This guy just took one look at my face, and the first thing he said was, "You must be the ugliest person I've ever met." So I'll kill myself if I look like that. That really hit hard.
Every single one of us has a big story. Events that make us who we are, shape us, inform what we do with our lives, who we become. These big stories are simply extraordinary, defining moments that make or break people. From them, we can learn, empathise and connect. These are the turning points that change people's lives. These stories must be told, starting right now. Joel Whitwell was born in the country town of Harvey, Western Australia, population 2,750. He entered the world in a small town, but had one big difference. Joel was born missing half his face. It's an extremely rare and potentially fatal condition. It was a miracle Joel survived his first few weeks after birth.
I was born, the technical term is cranial facial deficiency. It means one side of my face wasn't formed properly, so pretty much half a face. It's pretty rare, but it didn't deter Mum and Dad. Being the people they are, they were determined to give me the best start to life. I had obviously quite a few surgeries over the years. One that was in 1989, when they had to take a rib and put it inside of my face to bring my face out a bit more. In 99, 10 years later, the doctors took some muscle from my back to make like a cheek. I had to ask Mum exactly when, but I got my first glass eye very early on in life. As you can probably guess, as a kid, I had a lot of fun with it. One time, we had a pet dog, and I had my glass eye in my hand. I was looking at the texture, admiring it, and he jumped up and took it out of my hand and swallowed it. So I told Mum, and Mum, being pretty laid back as well, thought, "Oh well, how are we going to get the dog to throw it up?" And so Mum got salt water, made the dog drink it, and promptly threw it up. You know, lucky she cleaned it with disinfectant, and I put it back in and went about my day. Early on in life, I had to go to Perth to get a new ear, a plastic ear. At first, they had to glue it on. I was getting ready for school, and Mum would be like, "Oh, we've got to put the ear on." So she'll quickly glue it on, and I'll be like, "Quick on and go and see my friends." And sometimes she'll glue it too high or too low, and, you know, thank God my friends didn't really comment. But in school, from as far as I can remember, I never got bullied. I was one of the popular kids in school, and I think that really helped. And maybe it was a small town, maybe everyone knew our family, but I was one of the popular kids. So that was something that I look back now and I'm very thankful and grateful for. The thing I found a bit harder was whenever I left my comfort zone of Harvey, say, for example, when Mum had to take me to Perth to get a checkup, and I would see people staring. And as a kid, you know, and I remember Mum always saying, God bless her again, "The only staring because of how beautiful looking you are." And as a kid, you sort of believe everything that Mum says. So I went to a party when I was 19, and there was a guy there who was out of town, and he was there drinking, and this guy just took one look at my face, and the first thing he said was, "You must be the ugliest person I've ever met." So I'll kill myself if I look like that. You know, I just don't know what he was going through at the time. You know, it's a pretty harsh thing to say, but that really hit hard, just the bluntness of it. All I could do is just get up and walk back out, and my two friends followed me. They didn't know how to handle it because we were only 19, teenagers. And I didn't want to cry back then in front of my friends, so I dropped them off and I went to a quiet place. And obviously something like that just coming out of the blue hurt me, but I think that night, I sort of did a lot of thinking, and I thought, I knew in my heart something like that was going to happen sooner or later. That was definitely a big stepping stone to developing that thicker skin. Thinking, well, everyone's going through something like that at some point in life. And I think it's just having the right outlook. It could have scarred me for life, but I think I want to share that because I know everyone in life at some point's been hurt by words. You know, and I don't think people mean to be nasty. It's just spur the moment things. So it's time to just move on from things like that to become stronger. And yeah, and learn kindness. Try to be kind because we don't know what others are going through. Growing up, I was very lucky. I got a great network of good friends. EJ, I met him in 97. He moved to Harvey with his family. We became good friends in no time. Had the same outlook on life because we worked together. So we really formed a close bond that summer. And we did everything together. And at the end of that summer, I heard about these mystery flights where they fly anywhere in Australia. We're off to Sydney. You know, we're off to Sydney like it was like the end of the world. And it was probably one of the best days of my life. And TJ had his uncle Mick, who was a detective, and he lived in Sydney. We went up, met up with Mick. We were there having such a good time. And I seen there was someone sitting at the bar on his own. He was staring. And that was the first time I remember thinking, stare all the light, mate, I'm here with one of my best mates having such a good day. I'm not going to let it get to me. And I didn't. And that day in Sydney at the pub was the first day I sort of never let it get to me. I sort of overcame the challenge of people staring. Over the coming years, me and PJ spoke about that day and that trip often. And I remember PJ coming to the footy club, walking in, and one thing I do remember is I had my arm around him. And I told him that Sydney was just a start, mate. I've been looking up and I've been checking up America. And if you're keen, let's do America next year. And he seemed that happy. So we had plans to sort of continue on from Sydney. And it was always a dream to do America. And obviously there, the next day I woke up and bumped into someone I knew. And that's when he gave me the words that to this day I'll never forget. That PJ was killed early that morning driving back home, and it did it. Send me into a bit of a dark place, and then I thought, what could I do to honour his memory? And I thought, well, we started travelling together in Sydney, why not go on and see the world? That was always a dream of mine. Go through the dark stages, I think the more to do, the more to realise if I can get through this, push through, I believe there's going to be a blessing on the other side. Obviously with PJ, the blessing out of that was I finally left my comfort zone to live out my dream to travel the world. And the depression, it's something that comes and goes. Some days I may get it for a little bit, the darkness. Other times it sort of lingers, but I've always been such a positive guy, and I think it just keeps with that positive mindset, knowing that I've got that many good friends, family that I can talk to. Knowing that I'm well liked, just focusing on those positives and keeping those negative thoughts at bay the best way they can. If it wasn't for my family support, my friends, maybe who knows how my life would have turned out, but just having that support really helped. I don't think I would have ever left this world. I think, you know, suicide's a pretty taboo subject, but I could never do it to my parents. No matter how dark things get, my parents, what they've done for me and the type of people they are, that's definitely a shining light. I think we all get that darkness, some more than others, but I think my brightness and the light that I'm shining, especially on the world lately, it's coming out of that darkness. And again, I've always been a very positive, upbeat person by my upbringing. More and more as I've grown confidence, my light shines from within. And again, like Martin Luther King said, I have a dream. I do dream of one day, maybe just forgetting my life heard, we can live in a world that's a bit less superficial. And I do believe I can make an impact. If I can help one person, then I've done well, but I'm starting to feel now that it's going to help more than one. I think I am going to make a difference. Just having one ear and eye, I'm not the first person who's had a disfigurement, and I'm not the last. But I do believe it's what to deal with what they've been given, and I do believe my story is really starting to make an impact. So I want to make a difference in this world.
And Joel is doing just that. He's become a motivational speaker and has just published his autobiography, One Eye, One Ear, No Worries, available now.
Thank you.